Sidetrack Episode 11, Paul of Samosata and Lucian of Antioch Revisited. Welcome back to the History of the Papacy podcast. I'm Steve, your host for this podcast about the history of the popes of Rome and the Christian Church. If you're enjoying what you're hearing, take a moment and leave a review or rating at iTunes. I always very much appreciate and am thankful for all your feedback. You can also always comment and check out the show and blog notes and show notes and all sorts of great things at a2zhistorypage.com. And you can ask a question there, connect to Facebook and Twitter, and much, much more. Also, I would like to let you know that this episode is brought to you in part by Leatherman Data Services. If you're a historian, an archaeologist involved in cultural resource management and need the highest quality mapping or geographic data services, then Leatherman Data Services is the company for you. Take a look at their website, Leatherman Data Services, to learn more about the really cool work they do. These are the guys who love history as much as we do. So if you'd like to learn more about this great service, you can always email them at leathermandataservices@gmail.com. In the next few Sidetrack episodes, we'll take another look at a few personalities we've discussed earlier, but who we really need to talk about in some more detail. Reviewing and looking at people, ideas, and events again with a different perspective will happen quite a bit, especially in this series on the First Council of Nicaea. Two people who we will take a look at, but with a new perspective, are Paul of Samosata and Lucian of Antioch. Both of these people were important in their own day, and we talked about them, but their ideas were also very influential in the debates during the First Council of Nicaea. Both Lucian of Antioch and Paul of Samosata taught theologies and Christologies that were divergent from mainstream orthodoxy. But in their times, there really wasn't an orthodoxy that was written in stone. The idea of the Trinity, or that God existed in three persons, was an evolving and developing process. The nature of Jesus' divinity and humanity was also a work in progress. Different theologians and leaders took this idea of a Trinity and the questions of Jesus' divinity in different directions. In the mid-200s AD, these theological and Christological debates were important, but there were some existential problems as well. The Decius persecution had just ended, and the church was healing and trying to work out many problems of how to handle the lapsed and work with the new converts they were gaining on a daily basis. Paul of Samosata is both directly linked to the First Council of Nicaea. The baptisms of his sect were deemed to be not valid, and he was indirectly involved with some of his ideas. When Paul of Samosata fell out with the mainstream church, Lucian of Antioch fell out for a time as well, because he was seen as being too close to Paul. Let's keep in mind, Antioch was the home of the school of Antioch, a very important place for the development of Christian theological scholarship, on par with the catechetical school of Alexandria. Arius may have been from Libya and made his name in Alexandria, but he very likely studied at the school of Antioch. Paul of Samosata's ideas on the Godhead and the nature of Jesus definitely influenced the school of Antioch, but was modified by Lucian of Antioch. If you remember from the episodes about the Decius persecution and the crisis of the 3rd century, Paul of Samosata was not a popular character among the Orthodox, or maybe we should say proto-Orthodox at that time. Paul of Samosata was Patriarch of Antioch, but originally from a place called Samosata, which was a town further into Syria on the Euphrates River. All sorts of names and ideas have been attached to Paul. Was he a Sabellian, a modalist, a monarchian, an adoptionist, or was he simply an opportunist? Remember, Paul was accused of having all sorts of financial and liturgical irregularities, along with some questions about the appropriateness of his relationship with some of his women followers. He may have been a little too close with them, if you know what I mean. Did these accusations have some legs? I would say probably, but Paul also held views that were far outside of the mainstream. Some of the way he operated would have seemed very strange to his enemies. Also remember, the story we get of Paul today was written by his enemies, and the debate style of the day, as you could probably say of any day, was to completely pile on more and more accusations, even if they were just more and more outlandish. The details around his early life and background are for the most part non-existent, except that he was from Samosata and he was from humble beginnings. Basically, in 260 AD, he was elected, or possibly in some way selected, as Patriarch of Antioch. Paul of Samosata held a high civil office in the Palmyrene Empire and was very close to the Queen Zenobia, who was the leader of this breakaway empire. We don't need to worry much about all the details of the Palmyrene Empire, but what is important is that Zenobia was Jewish. Judaism had fallen on some hard times after the destruction of the Jerusalem Temple in 70 AD and the Bar Kokhba revolt in the 130s AD, but by the 260s, Judaism was definitely on the uptick. Judaism was the religion of a great number of people in the area of Antioch, and the Roman idea was not to persecute them, but just to make sure they didn't rebel. If the Jews weren't in rebellion, then everything was fine. Queen Zenobia was in rebellion, but that's a different story. As we know, Judaism is a very monotheistic religion, like Christianity, but where Christianity and Judaism part ways was over Jesus. Judaism definitely does not have any concept of God being divided into persons or hypostases or anything like that. John Henry Cardinal Newman, in his book The Arians of the Fourth Century, and other scholars seem to think Paul of Samosata's theology and the theology of the Antioch school in general was very much influenced by the prevailing Jewish theology of the area. Paul of Samosata was not Jewish, though, and he wasn't teaching a Jewish Christianity. We're not talking about something like the early Jewish Christians such as the Ebionites here. Paul's group held Jesus in very high regard. Maybe Jesus wasn't God, but he still was critically important for Christianity. Paul and his sect also did not follow the law as Jews did. No circumcision, kosher rules, or anything like that. Jesus to Paul and his sect was fundamentally different than the Jewish conception of the Messiah, or Mashiach. Judaism very well could have had an impact on Paul of Samosata's theology, but it was a big-picture theological or philosophical influence, not an adoption of Jewish practice or custom. It is quite difficult to exactly piece out Paul's theology because it was documented by the people who were very much against his ideas. Paul must have been more than just an opportunist who used the church to gain personal power and wealth. For one, Paul of Samosata's sect was denounced and their baptisms were pronounced to be invalid at the First Council of Nicaea. So over 50 years after his death, his sect was still active enough to gain the attention of the First Ecumenical Council, but after First Nicaea, his sect faded out. You can't really say Paul of Samosata was the father of Arius' theology, but maybe grandfather? Paul of Samosata strongly influenced another priest called Lucian of Antioch, who held beliefs that were outside the typical Orthodox viewpoint. Lucian of Antioch is the type of guy who really gets things all muddled in Christian history. Here is a person who is more than likely, for a good period of his life, in schism with the church because of his relationship with Paul of Samosata. Lucian really got in trouble for being too close to Paul, but not necessarily sharing all of his theological views. Eventually, Lucian becomes reunited with the church, and to round it all out, Lucian of Antioch becomes a saint of the Roman Catholic and Eastern Orthodox churches, because he was martyred during the final parts of the persecution of Diocletian under Maximin Daya in 312. Lucian of Antioch's theology seems to be more directly connected to Arius's, and many of the top Arian Leading bishops, including Eusebius of Nicomedia, were students of Lucian's. Paul of Samosata's beliefs fell outside of the mainstream, but it appears that Lucians were just inside of the proto-Orthodox spectrum. This is an idea we will develop further in future episodes. There was a ton of Christian groups out there at the time before Nicaea, probably more than today, and for sure they had much more divergent theologies than today's Christian groups. The majority of Christians fell somewhere in the Orthodox spectrum, meaning they were not Jewish Christians or Gnostics or anything like that. The separatist groups like the Novationists and the Donatists shared mostly similar ideas to the mainstream Orthodox, except they thought the mainstream Orthodox were deficient in their piety in some way, well, pretty much most ways. The Arians parted ways with the Gnostics and others, and they saw Jesus as being something similar to God, just not the exact same. On one side of the spectrum, you have the Arians who believe that Jesus was entirely created, all human in nature, and on the opposite side, the Miaphysites who held that Jesus' divine nature was completely covered by his human nature. But don't worry about that one either, because we'll get into that in a lot of detail further on. The item that would separate Paul of Samosata's theology from Lucian's and the Arians is in the Trinity. The theologies of Paul followed that God was undivided, the supreme monarch as the term goes. God appeared in different aspects to believers, but in reality, God was just one. It was all an appearance, a perception by the viewer, you might say. Jesus was an aspect of that one deity. God came down himself and inhabited Jesus the Christ during his ministry on earth. On the cross, either God was crucified along with Jesus the man, or God left Jesus the man on the cross right before Jesus the human died. Here is one of the major differences between Paul of Samosata's ideas and the ideas of some of his successors. To Paul, Jesus the man was a great man, but just a regular man who was adopted by God. Lucian of Antioch and later Arians would see Jesus as a created being, but a perfect being created before all ages. In a way, Arianism is a natural logical step from the beliefs of Paul of Samosata. If you can't get past the idea of Jesus being a regular man or the possibility of God being crucified, but you don't like that God can exist in three hypostases, then Arianism is a logical conclusion. God and Jesus are separate, not one. In Gnostic terms, Jesus would be thought of as the demiurge, or the creator of the word, the logos, and then hence the creator of the world. So there's a step between God, Jesus, and then regular creation. So now we can see Arianism was not a theological position that a priest named Arius cooked up all on his own in isolation. These ideas were floating around and being built upon for a long time, and it took a charismatic leader like Arius to essentially brand the theological position in opposition to Trinitarian orthodoxy. Also remember, Constantine wanted a unified religion after Nicaea, even if his idea of religion went more towards the all-powerful single God espoused by the Arians. In the next Sidetrack episode, we'll dig it even a little deeper to see more of the roots of the Arian position. To wrap up this Sidetrack episode, I hope I've walked the line in introducing enough of the theology and philosophy to keep the story in context and moving along, but not to get too bogged down in it. As I read about the Trinity, Arianism, Gnosticism, I'm not sure if anyone really completely understands it, but a little knowledge about the theology will help us when we get to the political and historical situation in the First Council of Nicaea and beyond. The History of the Papacy podcast is a proud member of the HistoryPodcasters.com network, where you can also check out many other great podcasts. A few I enjoy include Come and Take It, a Texas history podcast, the history of the Crusades, and just many, many more. Thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to seeing you on our next stop on our trip through the history of the Roman popes and Christian church.